and served as FAO consultant at Uzbekistan. He has also served as fellow of the Indian Society of Seed Technology, Indian Society of Seed Spices, Indian Society of Vegetable Science and Horticulture Society of India, and executive member, Indian Academy of Horticulture Science. I welcome you, sir, to chair the session.
Thank you, Dr. Kutty.
Thank you, sir.
Good morning, all of you. In this 3 days national e-webinar on breeding crops under sub-humid tropics, and it is my privilege to act as a chairman of the technical session 2, which will deal the breeding of cucurbits for humid tropics. Before initiating the technical session's presentation, I would like to mention in brief that cucurbits are very important part of the vegetable kingdom. It's part of fish. Improve the nutrition, missing crop on level of and we good the credit in the year need need and to area As a form to work. The water crop in it will be grown. And similarly, Mel not be protected. When put so one of harvest side. When is
Excuse me, Dawar sahab, aapka voice to break kar raha
hai. It is a very good variety for the amount of pulp and less amount of seed. A bit bits, but it's time. Then there was not a and they are. Fresh as well. We export. Bring down to. Pumpkin mostly season activity. Likewise, my Background. Also, phone. Presentation. That is invite the scientists who have been asked to have a presentation. Thank you, Dr. Sangeeta.
Thank you, sir. So we begin with the first talk, which is on breeding for biotic stress resistance in cucurbits by Mr. Mohammed Saleem, who is a senior breeder, Namdhari Seeds Private Limited, Bangalore. He's an eminent breeder who has involved in the development of BT cotton. He has also developed and released 5 BT cotton hybrids for commercial cultivation in all the cotton growing zones of India. He has been handling breeding and hybrid development of crops like icebox watermelon, rich gourd, sponge gourd, bottle gourd, and presently he is working as senior breeder, majorly focusing on breeding of cucumber, rich gourd for India and Southeast Asia market.
I have completed over my initial mark as chairman of the session. Now you can start the presentation, sir. Dr. Pradeep, you can start the presentation.
Yes, right? Sir.
Yes, I'm audible.
Yes. Yeah, you are audible.
Sir, please mute. Sir, please mute your audio.
You can start the presentation.
Yeah.
No, Thomas, no. Sir, please in mute the screen, your only audio. Dr. Pradeep Kumar T is appear. Still, I am. Oh, so
sir,
I
please
should
mute
stop
your
video.
Audio, sir.
Okay. I need to give the beginning of the lecture. We can start the presentation.
Mr. Mohammed Saleem, please go ahead with your presentation.
Expert who is.
Good morning, everybody. I hope I'm audible.
Yeah, you are audible.
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. Shall I be sharing my screen or?
Salim, you are right, so you are audio. Please go ahead.
Hello,
I'm working as a senior breeder in Kupo at Namdhari Seeds. Thank you for that. Now, since the topic what was given was biotic stress resistance, would almost cover a lot of entire book, I believe. So I would be discussing on approaches that are reported till date for biotic stress resistance in cucumber. Cucumber now. Shall we go to the next slide? The cucurbitaceae hosts many economically important vegetable fruit crops such as cucumber, watermelon, pumpkin, squash, and various gourds. Cucurbitaceae is a family that offers mankind with diverse kind of tastes like sweet, bitter, acidic, and nutrition. It also helps us maintain a healthy source of lifestyle. The family fits itself into different cuisines as such, ranging from we can have any member of the cucurbit family as a salad or in a complete cook format. You name the cuisine, the members of cucurbit family fit into it. The cucurbitaceae family majorly contains water and and can be considered as major contributors in the healthy diets of the people of present day, because our lifestyle has grown as more prone us to the lifestyle diseases like diabetes and obesity. Nutritionally, the cucurbits are a rich source of vitamin, as Dr. Kumar was rightly pointing out. These are the very rich source of vitamins, minerals, and proteins, and very low in fats. They add volume to our diet, but no fats. Hence, this can be a perfect dietary supplement. And a cucurbit family member that suits cultivation of each and every kind across the globe, right from a backyard farming to a complete mechanized and technically oriented hat melons that are the costliest melons available in the globe. They vary even in terms of sizes, which can the baby fingers, which are baby cucumbers, which are just the size of which can be held in a palm, the giant pumpkins of the Spanish pumpkin festivals. Now, in just introduction to this family, would stretch to write a book, I believe. So I'd be concentrating on one particular crop which I'm dealing right now, the cucumbers. Their name and true to their family fit in every kind of diversity, but they are mostly loved as salads. And cucumbers are almost grown across the places. Across the places in the globe and under various environmental conditions, hence exposing them to various kind of diseases and pests and biotic and abiotic stresses as such. As I am dealing with biotic stresses today, I would start my presentation with the most important disease in cucumber. What we see is the powdery mildew. Caused mainly by two organisms. One is Golvinomyces sicoriacearum and Podosphaera xanthi. Podosphaera xanthi is one of the most widely occurring pests in cucumber across the globe, and various studies have been are being conducted. The reports range from the resistance in, against powdery mildew range from being reported as a single recessive gene to with employment of latest technology, these have been identified as QTL effects. Now, powdery mildew resistance is also said to be co-localized with downy mildew resistant as well. With recent development in the studies, there are various chemical pathways and various genes involved in that confer the resistance. But most important one is the Kukumi Satayama gene, where it was observed that this gene was providing durable resistance against species. Can we go to in 40s, he was able to find out that powdery mildew resistance is a kind of multiple recessive gene. Then Shanmugasundaram was first to identify that classify the powdery mildew resistance at two different stages of plant growth. One would be at the hypocotyl stage, and another would be at to the leaf. Hypocotyl resistance was told to be governed by a single recessive gene, and that holds good even today. And that was again proven by Derivator et al., where they identified gene PMH that was conferring resistance at the hypocotyl stage. And for leaf stage, there have been various reports that ranging from a single gene from the source used till the up to 9 QTLs have been reported. Now, with the recent studies and fine mapping of the QTLs, it is seen that chromosome 5 of the cucumber genome harbors most of the QTLs responsible for powdery mildew resistance. Next slide, please. Present the paper of Jing Tao et al., who have finally mapped the QTL PM 5.1 on the long arm chromosome, long arm of fifth chromosome. Here they have used different techniques to find gene find this particular gene. They have started from selecting the parents that were highly resistant and highly susceptible. They have developed a F2 population. In the F2 population, these were gene 2 years. Then the F2 population was developed. In the F2 population, they have bulked 10 highly resistant plants and 10 of the susceptible plants. And they went on to screen these using 900, among 906 markers. They have narrowed down to 106 markers. Then they were able to particular resistance on the long arm chromosome of long arm of fifth chromosome. In order to finally map the QTL, they have developed second segregating populations like BC3F1, BC2F2 as net source, and they have tried to use different SSR to again confirm that this PM5.1 is the major source of source to provide resistance in the cucumber. Further, they went on to identify CSMLO cucumber sativa's MLO like gene, down regulation of which was helping in the durable resistance. Can we go to the next? In order to they initially based on the F2 population phenotyping, it was seen that the resistance was normally distributed. Hence, and even in the reels, the resistance was normally distributed. Hence, it was seen that the resistance is almost like a resistive kind of resistance. They use various polymorphic SSRs distributed on all the 7 chromosomes and developed various linkage groups on all. And further, markers were added to form linkage groups and narrowed down to 5th chromosome, that the gene was present on the 5th chromosome. This was done by using 9 polymorphic markers, which identified that PM5.1 was the candidate UTN. Can we go to the next slide? Now they have tried to develop the population. S1003 was the resistant parent and S1001 was the susceptible parent. This was phenotyped for 2 years in the epiphytotic conditions. The F1, what they observed was as susceptible as susceptible parent. And again in F2, the susceptibility, there normal distribution is susceptibility, and hence they went for a bowel segregating analysis, as I was explaining earlier. In order to develop the alternate segregating population, since 1003 and 1001 were very much closely related, probably I would like to add another point. 1003, the resistance source was probably from Indian origin. Then 1003 and 1001, as they were very much close and differing only for that particular locus, this was used for bulk segregating analysis. And further, for fine mapping, they used another susceptible parent, S05. Then one was crossed with the recurrent parent, S100. Among one 122 plants of BC1F1, one heterotic plant which is segregating only for 5.1 and having most of the background genes of 103 in a homozygous state was chosen, and again backcross. Then there were the 90 plant population was generated. Similar thing was done for one step, and another BC2F1 was then BC2F2 was generated, and the same BC2F1 plant was again backcrossed to generate BC3F1 for the further fine mapping of the genotypes. Here the 9 polymorphic markers were used. The markers U, the SSR markers U65011 and 65190 are the two polymorphic markers that were seen to be flanking the QTL 5.1. Can we move? Yeah, this is what I was explaining, the distribution of normal distribution in the F2 population with respect to resistance and susceptibility. We can use some kind of discrete distribution. This is from the average DI volume, incidence value, which was with respect to segregating population, secondary population, secondary segregating population. Since the distribution was skewed towards susceptibility more, it was indicating that the effect of major, it is the effect of a major recessive allele. Yeah, analysis in F2 plants, as I suggested, they went for a bulk segregant analysis of 10 resistant and 10 susceptible population. They screened 106 out of 780 SS markers. These 106 markers were found to be polymorphic between the parents, but the 4 SSR markers listed below, 14194, 184, 89, 13078, and 6904, were from a contagious region of chromosome 5, which picked up the PM5.1 and indicated that the particular location where the UTL is located. Can we move to the next slide? Here we can see what they did after they went on to clone that particular region, and this clone and resequenced the region, and it almost went up to 81 centimorgan linkage map was covered for to identify this. Then with this we can see one particular 0635. This particular marker was identifying PMR 5.1, and based on the log value, candidate genes that were identified, based on the log value of 12, it was seen that PM 5.1 was expressing and defining most of the variations with respect to resistor, and this was designated as further for the fine mapping of Q, there was a field screening also done in the secondary segregating population like BCPF1, BCPF2, it was seen that the resistance is almost resistant to susceptibility ratio in BC1, BC3F1 and BC1F1 was like 1:1, 1:1 segregation, and in F2 was 1:3, further confirming the hypothesis that this is a kind of recessive inheritance. This PM5.1 locus was delimited in a 1.8 centimargin interval between two tracking markers, 65011 and 76. Then, as I was telling in the slide, so 5% then this was again confirmed by screening with they observed various recombinants also, and they also identified they also ran this marker on the from Chinese germplasm. This again confirmed 5.1 is the major UTL that is contributing the resistance towards border media. Can we go to the next slide? Yeah. After identifying the PM5.1, they cloned the resistance that were obtained. They do the genes and map genes, and even the gene order what they could map was fitting into the maps that were already available publicly. Hence, based on the cloning, it was observed that this 1449 base pair insertion into the gene was the result that led to the down regulation of MLO-like genes and further confirming better durable resistance towards powdery mildew. And also this one particular SNP substitution was seen in case of some of the resistant lines like 77, 78 and 79. This they claim 5.1 is the major is the first major QTL reported, and this whole can you go ahead? Powdery mildew, We'll be focusing on the resistance mechanism of downy mildew. As I have earlier said, downy mildew is also one of the most major pests that disease that is affecting. Once the downy mildew comes, it's almost impossible to control. So now we have that are able to manage the disease but not completely eradicate the disease. And with rising awareness regarding organic food consumption or residue of chemicals, it's always a challenge to have a resistant source that could even save some money into the pocket of the farmer. So again, in case of downy mildew, it was seen that the reports are vary from single recessive inheritance to a qualitative manner. To just introduce regarding Pseudospora cubensis, this was first this pathogen was first identified in herbariums of Cuba, hence the name. Then the resistance mechanism varies from gene for gene specific to gene non-specific, and there is a kind of reports of systematically acquired resistance as well. The downy mildew resistance is varies for different crops. Like in melons, it is a kind of dominantly inherited, is a QTL based. Et al. In 1960, the downy mildew is three recessive genes. This was the effect of three recessive in the cultivar called Ajohi. Then later, these three recessives were designated as DM1, 2. This was Mason in 1974. Contradictorily, they claimed that in particular concept, the downy mildew resistance was a kind of single gene recessive inheritance. As I was explaining during the downy mildew discussion, also that downy mildew resistance in cucumber is almost kind of co-segregating with the downy mildew. And Cucumis hystrix can be a major source of resistance to downy mildew. There are studies that that have Cucumis hystrix contains most of the major materials that comes the downy mildew. Can you please move ahead? This is a most recent paper where they have tried to clone most of the regulating for powdery mildew and downy mildew resistance. Here we can clearly see that many that are segregating on the chromosomes, like PM 6.1 will be co-segregating here, downy mildew 6.2. Then we have 1.1 segregating with M1.1. These were again classified into pairs. Almost five pairs were reported in different cultivars in across generations. So downy mildew. Again, it was established to be a quantitatively inherited trait, but still there is a lot of work to be done to achieve the resistance in downy mildew. Coming to the important viral disease in cucumber that almost results in 40 to 60% of and a kind of global pandemic kind of presence in case of cucumber and other many of the things makes resistance against EMV is very wide host range, and it has a very wide range of vectors as well. CMV. And again, like other crops, repeated resistance are not consistent because various infection and different experimental designs were removed. Yes. Munshi et al. In way back, they used Cucumis hardwicki as one of the source for. It was seen that Cucumis hardwicki was almost immune kind of reaction towards CMV. They went for interspecific cross with Cucumis sativa. It was seen that it is a kind of monogenic inheritance with three susceptible and one resistant, telling that it is a kind of recessive reaction. And this was further confirmed by them with backcrossing with the susceptible parent, where the backcross population segregated into 1:1 ratio. This was not just only on one cross between one accession. They had selected various accessions and crossed and had an interspecific process done. Based on these, can we move ahead? Based on these ratios, it Cucumis hardwicki harbors the recessive related resistance. We can kind of various accessions that were from India, Nepal, Bangladesh, China of Cucumis hardwicki, and and we can see susceptible to moderately completely resistant kind of reaction in case of CMV resistance. And some of the commercial cucumbers were also evaluated with these all resistant lines, and they were found to be pretty susceptible. Yeah. What I was explaining, they crossed the susceptible DC1, DC1, DC2, and CST with different sources of hardwicki, and it was in all the in all the crosses in all the crosses the six generation mean analysis confirmed that it is a kind of single gene recessive inheritance. Everywhere there was a kind of 1:1 segregation, or in case of backcross population, and in case of F2 it was identified as 3:1, and even in F2 it was 3:1 kind of segregation process. Can you move? Then they claim that Cucumis hardwicki would be one of the source for best resistance source, and the interspecific cross would help in developing the chromosome substituted lines. Then reports changed with evolving technology that there were almost 17 QTLs that were reported in an F2 population. And this F2 and the recent videos are most found to be distributed in all the 7 chromosomes. Further, the among the CMV1 to CMV17, on the 6th chromosome and was explaining 67% of the total variations. Contradicting to that, there were reports claiming that it is a single dominant gene reaction, and there were reports of CMV resistance being 1/3 dominant dependent genes. But still today, the QDL mechanism is not responsible for CMV till now. Can we go to the next slide? Xie et al. Recently, they tried to find map. They tried to study the inheritance and find map the QTLs on in the against CMV in cucumber. They developed real populations for resistance. In the phenotyping was. They went for phenotyping and observed a very normal for the disease resistance reaction, and most of them were kind of that helped them identify the hypothesis of QTL. Then they listed 1228 SSR markers, of which 296 were polymorphic, and they selected 97 markers that were distributed well across all the 7 chromosomes, and they developed various linkage 7 linkage groups for 7 different chromosomes. Then linkage group 6 the linkage group on 6th chromosome was explaining the most of the variations. Identified on the 6th chromosome, the QTL 6.1 is located on 32.7 centimorgan, and it is delimited by 2 SSR markers, SSR 9-56 and SSR 11-176. Yeah, this is what I was explaining. This is the kind of phenotyping they had done in real population. All the real population in comparison with the parents, the resistance is almost normally distributed, hence predicting it to be QTL. QTL variation, but when they studied this in 2 seasons, there was a spike in case of towards resistance. Can you move to the next slide? Yeah, we can. This SSR, this particular region was again cloned and sequenced. Then, and this was again mapped on the available publicly available pattern, and it was confirmed that the gene order again was fitting normally. Based on this, SSR11-1 identified the resistant lines. They screened various resistant lines, the recombinants, new resistant lines. Saw that from 78 resistant lines, the SSR-1 was picking up almost 94% of the times. It was picking up the resistance. Hence, it was clear that CMV 6.1 is the so major QTL source that confers the resistance on CMV. After this, knowing that CMV 6.1 is one of the major gene responsible for resistance. They cloned and mapped it in the genome database. This particular sequence was annotating one particular gene, BZIP transcription factor family protein. BZIP transcription family protein. And this was the gene that was responsible for CMV resistance. Further, they cloned the sequences from the resistant and susceptible lines, and they found that there is SNP variation at 5' and A to C substitution, and at 3' end there is again different CT and GC substitution that was resulting in the difference of resistance and susceptible reaction in the cucumber. Can you move ahead? Coming to with this available information, though I have covered only three diseases here, most of the disease resistance, take it GSP, as sir was explaining during his introduction, introductory talk, that GSP is one of the most important pathogen that is coming up in most of the cucurbit cultivation. That is almost true in case of cucumber as well. GSP is also has also been identified as kind of QTL operated resistance, and further fusarium wilt is also kind of there are reports that fusarium wilt would be a single gene resistance, or it can even be a quantitative. Since most of the most of the traits right from the disease resistance to yield are being classified into quantitatively inherited traits, we need to narrow down on the breeding approaches what we need to follow to achieve the best possible lines. When we can go for wide crossing, as we have evidently seen that Cucumis hystrix and Cucumis arbiki were the resistance sources for many of the resistance sources for against many of the pathogens. Wide crossing can be one of the option. When we go for wide crossing and we are handling the qualitative quantitative traits, going for a double haploid or through ovule culture or androgenesis would help us narrow down on the genetic variance component, and thus double haploids can be employed in wide along with wide crossing. And wide crossing can also be done with backcrossing in a conventional or molecularly assisted backcrossing method. Then we can employ the recent CRISPR technology, which helps in targeting a particular site that is responsible for and cause mutation, and thus give us enough variation that would be developing most of the resistant lines. Transgenic could be an option, but again the regulatory aspects of transgenics in India would be a question mark to use transgenic as a source of commercial breeding, in especially in the food crops. That is what we for B2B generation. Can we? Yeah. With this brief presentation, I would we can conclude that genetics of resistance in most of the cases still needs to be confirmed and standardized. And for us as a breeders and agriculture scientists, nature poses new challenges every in each and every moment of time. Hence, we breeders need to be on toes and disrupt the latest technologies combating the challenge so that farmers face minimal losses and develop resilient varieties that can stand any sort of challenge. Therefore, protect the interest of farmers and in turn ensure food and nutrition security to the mankind. All these kind of thoughts we have strive to breed seeds for better future. Any questions? I think I have ended my talk in way before time that was allotted to me.
Thank you, Dr. Singh, for your presentation and summarizing the genetics of powdery mildew and CMV. You include all the basic informations and for okay. Question. You can read the question and will be for answer.
Chairman, I think let the attendees note down their questions in the chat box. They may write the if any questions in the chat box so that even in the end we can answer it.
Okay, right. Take care, Pradeep.
Okay, then so I think we can move to the next presentation.
Next speaker.
To your presentation. Yeah.
So we shall move on to the next presentation, which is on molecular breeding in cucurbits. Professor Tushar Kanti Behra is a principal scientist at the Division of Vegetable Science at IARI New Delhi. He's a veteran vegetable breeder with 20 years of experience in vegetable breeding. He has bred around 18 varieties and hybrids in different crops. He's a fellow of the National Academy of Agricultural Science, Indian Society of Plant Breeding and Genetics, Indian Academy of Horticultural Science, Indian Society of Vegetable Science. He has also bagged several prestigious awards, including Dr. Kirti Singh Gold Medal for Best Researcher in Vegetable Science. I welcome you, sir, for the talk.
So can you share, because this share is not coming here. I am audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir.
So, for sharing, just give me a permission to share the.
Just
a minute,
sure.
So you have been granted the permission to share your PowerPoint.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir, it's visible, sir.
Something saying it is about or something like that. It's not moving, yeah.
So you can make it full screen. Yes, sir, it is visible, sir.
Okay. So, respected chairman of the session and Dr. K.P. Peter is the president of Indian Society of Vegetable Science. Dr. Pradeep Kumar, my colleagues, the friends, and I think most of them are also the students also joining here. This topic is a very vast topic because a lot of work has been done in the molecular breeding in cucurbits just after the sequence is over by the many of the crops. If you say that cucurbits is a whole group and you have known that it is a lot of species or genera is available in this particular crop, and most of them, many of them are very much of edible, and if you come across the cucurbits, it's a very huge family. And then we have to have some of the crops where the molecular approach is going in parallel with the other other crops or the other cereal and other crops. So if you see that crops like cucumber, melon, muskmelon, watermelon, and cucumber, we have done it with the genomic resources are available. So a lot of the breeding program is in the now in the fast track. So I'll go the outline of this program is this topic is the introductions, the development of markers and mapping of the traits, identification of candidate genes using linkage maps, development of this using mass, and broadening of these genetic resources, genomic resources with mass, that markers at selection, high throughput genotyping and marker at selection, strategy for marker selections in vegetable crops and genome editing. So these are the, some of the touch I will go there. And I have some of the experience in different crops, particularly in cucumber as well as in bitter gourd. I have some experience. So I'll give you my example also there. And some of the things which is also done with some of the people across the country, I will give you just clips of them, not that full coverage. I cannot do it here in this small presentation. Cucurbits breeding started because you know that the conventional breeder started the cucurbit breeding long back in 1946. If you see the well-known breeder like B.P. Powell and Dr. Harvinder Singh, we started the work on conventional breeding in the cucurbit, particularly in 1946. The first paper, which is published in Indian Journal of Genetics and Plant Breeding, particularly the manifestation of hybrid vigor in brinjal and bitter gourd. So this is the one which I got it from 1946 and did that paper also to me. After that, the Singh Ramanujan also started a lot of work, and we have the Nature also publications are there. Inheritance of sex forms in the Lufa Ecotangula that we call as your there is a rich gourd. A lot of varieties also been developed by many of the people, and Dr. B.B. Pal, Dr. B. Chaudhary, and also the breeders which is also started, Dr. P.S. Siroi and Dr. V.S. Sasadri, and they are the topmost breeder in the cucurbits in the world itself. And they contributed a conventional breeding approach by which a lot of vegetable varieties, in particular to the cucurbits, have been developed. Now, coming to the phylogenetic tree of these cucurbits, it is by Yichun Wang. They have a publication of paper that is Cucumis sativa hardawicki, and these are the cucumber which is done just originated in India, and some of them are originated in America, and some are also in Africa and Zoom. Few of them, like Beninska hispida, it is even said to be originated in India, but Australian, they're telling it is also originated in India, in Australia. But in case of Momodica, Cochin chinensis and Charansia, it should be also originated in Asia. Now, coming to the major breeding objectives of cucurbits, what type of actually we need it for that? One is that yield improvement, which is good plant vigor, high male and female, there is a female and male ratio, early maturity and harvest, disease resistance, and it should have a very qualitatively improvement should be also there, both intrinsic level as well as extrinsic fruit quality, like shape, size, color, tubercles, rigidness, and these are the most important traits for which you need to have a cucurbit breeding. Extending shelf life is also very important, and extending growing season like off-season cultivations and protected cultivations, which is the most important in cucurbit breeding program. Now the topic is that molecular breeding. What we say the molecular breeding, how it is different from the conventional breeding? Molecular breeding can be defined the use of genetic manipulations performed for DNA levels to improve the trait of interest. So it is the first and basic definitions of the molecular breeding. It is only the use of genetic manipulation, but in case of conventional breeding also we are doing. But here, you know that how much the genes are there, which are the functionality of the genes are there, we know, and then the DNA levels we know, then only you can go for this particular event of molecular breeding, where you have to go for genetic manipulation through marker-guided selections or for genomic selection. But broadly, if you say the molecular breeding, it is based on this marker-guided breeding selection. The transgenic approach is also said to be the molecular breeding. But now till today, we have some problems in the transgenic development, and that's why it stopped. But only important thing here is the molecular biotechnology, which is called as marker-guided selections. You have to go for linkage maps, genomic studies, and alter the improve the traits of basic for the genotypic assay. Now, these are some of the tools why we are using for these biotechnology interventions for molecular breeding. One is the tissue culture. You must be knowing about the tissue culture if you go for transgenic development. If you go for somatic embryogenesis development, also going from the synthetic seeds, double haploids, protoplast fusion and side date. So these are the, some of the techniques you must be knowing if you go for manipulations of the genetics and the functionality of the genes. If you know, you want to know, then definitely you have to go for this tissue culture technique, which is very, very important, particularly to know the gene function, which is to be go for the omics, what we, or we call it omics. Now, coming to the genetic transformation is a very regular process. The people have tried many way, but because of the, some of the problems in this transgenics, we are not going to for this one. But the most important thing is the CRISPR-Cas, which is the target genome editing. Now coming to the new era of molecular biology, which is also important, but it is, even if it is a transgenic, but there is some regulations are there which can also minimize the process of these transgenics here. Now the most important here in the molecular breeding, that is genomic assisted plant breeding, which is mostly done in many of the cereal crops, particularly rice, wheat, and other crops. Many of the people have done it, a lot of work with the genomic assisted plant breeding, and they develop the varieties which is also resistant to different biotic and abiotic stresses, having the good quality traits. And these are also very important for the vegetable is concerned, because we have to develop the varieties both as a quality as well as a yield potential point of view. And it should also resistance to biotic and abiotic stresses. But the problem is that we don't have so much of genomic resources or genomic information is available with this particular crop, but some of the crops are really good work has been progressed. So I already mentioned with the genomic sequence by the horticulture plants. If you see that in vegetable itself, 42 plants already sequenced. And if you see this cucurbitalis, there are 11 cucurbitaceae family in which 11 crop plants already sequenced by the Chinese people. But if you are having concern with the Indian is concerned, we don't have any of the crops, we don't have any of the associations with the genomic information, particularly for developing a genomic sequence in this particular crop. But we have to try for that. The genome sequence, as already mentioned about that, cucumber is done, watermelon in 2012, and muskmelon also in 2012. And also we have cucurbita done in 2013, and momodica, we already started working in that. And 2017-18, we have paper of that genome sequence in the momodica done, but it is only a draft genome. So we are also having associated with this, some of the publications with the Japanese, where we are going for this momodica balsamina to be sequenced. And that is a very important crop in this particular momodica group, which also we are at a part of that program. Now this reference genome and the pan genome. So as I mentioned, there is three reference genome, the four or five crops, the reference genome is available, but we have to go for pan-genomic, which is very, very important, because a single reference genome cannot be giving a sufficient identifying the best candidate genes, but you have to go for more number of genetic background population. Definitely it will give a more genomic structures variation, and by which the genome sequence obtained from these different number of genotypes, you can re-sequence them, and then you have compared them, then you can get a lot of information in this particular aspect. This pan genome is very important, because it is only that resequencing of the number of genetic resources to understand the size of the core genome, the amount and nature of variations within the species and genus, which is very, very important, understanding the evolutions of the species of the genus, which is also required for the pan genomic studies. Now, if you see this draft genome, which is done by this Jinping Zhang when he was in USA, I met him there in USA, he was a very kind gentleman. And he worked on this particular watermelon for last 38 years. Now he's in Syngenta in Beijing. Now what is happening that assembling the genomic sequences, particularly for the watermelon, about 83.2% coverage were there for the genomes. And genetic linkage also he tried with different 11 chromosomes. And also he also sequenced some of the 20 diverse accessions of these Citrullus lanatus. He studied the evolutions of the genetic relationship with the resequencing of about 465 watermelon accession. That means you can see the how the resequence data has been generated by this watermelon, this gentleman. And he has given a lot of insight to this relationship with different species like Citrullus neodinensis, Citrullus colocynthis, Citrullus remi, Igneous, amorous, and ascetic type of Citrullus lanatus, as well as the variations also found in the Citrullus lanatus landraces with Citrullus lanatus traditional American ecotype. So there's a lot of variations, and you find there's a very clear grouping of this type of species, as well as the different varieties is concerned with respect to this particular water relaxations. So these are all resequenced, and that is a very important information with report for this PAN genomic studies in case of watermelon. Now coming to the one by one, I'll go through the development of markers and mapping traits. As you know that many of these markers have been developed in the cocoa beets. If you see the melons, cucumber, watermelon, cucurbita. And this is only because of these genetic sequences or genomic sequences already available in this crop. So we can develop a lot of markers with respect to this crop. But in other crop, it is an unknown crop. It is very, very difficult if you don't have a genomic information or you don't have a genomic resources or sequences available. It is very, very difficult to develop the markers and to map the traits of your interest. Now coming to some of the example in Sir Bitter Gold, we've started with some of the work with the development of the EST markers, and that we should go for this flowering traits in the bitter melon, and which also is published in that by these methods of transcript analysis, we can also develop some of the genes which is having downregulated and also upregulated. But knowing that behavior, we can take that particular region and we can find some of the development of the markers, particular traits. And we have already developed for this SSR markers. And some of them are also showing this type of polymorphic in this particular. So this is the methods by which we have to develop some of the markers with respect to where there is an unknown genome is there. But it's a known genome, there is no problem. You can get a lot of markers evolutions in this particular crop, and you can develop your mapping populations, and you can map them for particular traits. And again, we tried with this, particularly for this, and its genomic libraries level also, if it is known, it is not known to you, the genomic information, you can also try with respect to this one. And we generated about 160 microcircular markers with Mammatica challensia. And we also studied the diversity with respect to the different species of this Mammatica, as well as the other species of cocoa pits. But whenever you have some genomic information is available, there is no problem, you can try with this marker development. Now you have to go for mapping. So that is a biparental and association mapping part. So this is very important for the student's point of view, as well as those scientists working on this particular crop, going to have a lot of information for the molecular breeding. They must try with different cross combinations, different mapping system, like biparental mapping system, association mapping, they can also try. I'll give you an example in case of mapping. Dr. Salim was asking, just telling about this powdery mildew resistance cucumber. So in our group here also there in US, Dr. Yichin Wang group, he published a work in TAG, and they have got it some of the information with respect to the QTLs, particularly PM5-1, what is Dr. Salim was telling, and PM5-2, which is observed those located in the chromosome interval of 40 centimeter distance in the chromosome 5. And they have a explaining that is about 21 to 74.5% phenotype variation. So this is a very, very close proximity with respect to this QTL is concerned. And they have a lot of information, so the percentage of contribution to the phenotype variations, which is also found and which is in the chromosome number 5. Now coming to another work that is by Fukino et al. In 2013, and they have also taken the 111 reels on this particular crop, and they have taken only one weedy cucumber of Indian origin, which is resistant, so highly resistant to the powdery mildew. Why am I going to say the Indian germplasms are really having a lot of operations, a lot of information related to the biotic and abiotic stresses. If you consider the muskmelon, we have PA11609, and we have also many of the crops. Those are in the plant internet resistance in the USA. When I work there, I can see that a lot of materials which is generated there are of Indian origin. And they have a trait of interest up there. And we have to also, but in India, we don't have this type of, we have to ask for the materials from them, then they are supplying for this particular event. So my concern is that we have a lot of genetic resources, but we don't have a lot of genomic resources, which we have to go for in the breeding program. Then validated with the QTLs like PM31, PM5.1 and 5.2 and 5.3. So they are very much of closely linked with some of the markers, and also they have span about 693 centimorgans distance, and they can have a lot of information with respect to this marker developed in this particular trait. Then we tried in this powdery mildew resistance, so particularly for the association mapping. We have taken about 250 genotypes, which is enough. Without replication, then the fungal conidial spell is given. So that should be very important, because when you go for any experiment with the phenotypic evaluations of the or screening of this powdery mildew, downy mildew, and other things, definitely you have to go for that artificial screening, which is very important. And then you score them in different stages, like hypocotyl stage. Then you have to go for the true leaf stage, that is 14, 19, and 24 days. Because the variations on the powdery mildew also, the infection also related to the, when you go for the days progressions, you can find a lot of variations will be there with respect to the infestations of this powdery mildew. Now we also map them. We do about 240 SSR markers, polymorphic markers. We map them, and we have also publications to come up. And this is also associated with this US people, that is Yichun Wang Lam. And in that panel, we have about taking about 250 genotypes. And if you see that scoring, how we have to go for scoring from the 0 to 9. And that is a very, very tricky situation when you go for the hypocotyl stage also, and also in case of your in the broadleaf stage or the true leaf stage, which is very, very important to score them. And you can say that you have a clear cut demarcation between susceptible lines, and you can see the highly resistant line, also the susceptible lines there. And you can put it in the prot tray, and also you can screen a lot of materials. But the only thing is that you have to also have a susceptible plants should be there in this greenhouse. And that is very important. So that we have susceptible lines and highly resistant line. And after that, we have a very, very robust system of artificial screening, and we got the resistant line. And then we go for association mapping, and we got some of the in the fear in the chromium file. Now coming another trait, that is a target leaf spot resistance, which is very, very important. And then I mentioned about this. When you go for any resistance against the biotic stresses, particular diseases, also you have to go for screening is very important. Here you can see that target leaf spot, which is very, very easy for going into the culture for culturing. And then I did it this one in US also, the standardization of protocol for screening. The first, because this is a very, very tricky pathogen. So it's very, very difficult to sometimes it gives a very good symptoms, and sometimes it is not given. Even if there is change in the relative humidity and temperatures, because the normal growing, as I mentioned, with in cucumber with 25 in the day temperature and 20 degrees Celsius in the night temperature, RH should be 60 to 70%, and 14 to 10 hours, these are day and light period, should be there. So very, very cheap. It is only can be done in the growth chamber. So once you just put it them in this growth chamber, and you have to infest with that particular pathogen spore, you have to see that they are to be done or in the leaf sample or leaf side. We have to spray them, and there will be exact concentrations of this virus, of these pathogens. You have to put it there, and you have to screen many of the genotypes. So I have screened about 46-47 genotypes with respect to this cucumber, but some of them, like Wisconsin 2757, WI75 through, and True Lemon, GY14, these are the very good materials they have, and there are also some of them are showing very good, particularly for the susceptibility and resistance is concerned. And just you have to go for screening them, even in the probe tray, and you can find that is how this pathogens is reacting to them. So you have to then do the QTL mapping. And again, we did this QTL mapping in the chromosome 6. There is resistance, is the carbon, and that also mapped. And we can find some of the markers which is linked to this resistance to the tomato leaf curl. This TLS, target leaf spot. Another important thing is that when you go for the small studies with a different type of, because if you don't have a lot of resources, then you have to go for simple trait for taking of the particular genes. And respect to done, we have done in case of bitter gourd, where we have just take the genes for tubercles in the bitter gourd. As you know that the tubercles is governed by the single gene and is a dominant gene. So we tag them with the markers, that is MSSSR20, which is even 12.5 centimeter distance. But we have to go for fine mapping, where you can have a markers which is very close, maybe less than 5 centimeter distance. We have to just see. But the genome information is bitter gourd is now available in the public domain. Now we are carrying out a lot of work in this particular bitter gourd mapping is concerned. We also validated some MC. SSR 20 SSR markers with respect to link to the fruit tubercles with different genotypes, and we can find that there's a close proximity of that particular markers, which comes to differ the tubercles and non-tubercles type. Now, coming to the tagging of the genes for the fruit rigidness, I already mentioned that also it is also governed by the single gene, but the continuous discontinuous ridges govern the dominant over these continuous ridges, and also we find one marker which is SSR JY004, which is having just distance of 19.6 centimolar Moulin distance. Then again, we can also go for some genotyping by sequencing, which is also used for mapping of the different traits, and it is also done in the Bitter Gold. And we have to go for detections of the sequence differences, particularly SNPs, because now the lot of next generation sequencing is available. So now the people have stopped some of the work with respect to the SSR and other markers, but they are not going directly to the SNPs to get that particular best pair where you can go for changing this base pair, how is limiting your genome expressions. So that also study is going on. So we have to detect some of the sequence differences in large segregating populations of people already tried. And this repeat and direct studies of the diversity target towards the map of trait and mutations of the impacts. So this is very, very important for the genotyping by sequencing study nowadays. And we have to go for the sequencing and SSP and SNP identification. We have to multiplex them for sequencing and we have to go for SNP calling. And you can also have this, some of the reels you have to develop, and some haplotypes also you can generate, which is having similar to your parent or parent from one of this parent, which is also for interest for you. And then you can identify particular genes which is contributing to this particular trait. Now this QTL mapping also done in this GBS, as I already mentioned. So we published in the Frontend Plant Science that 93 libraries which also prepared with the Illumina 2 sequence, and we can find that this data library is about 18.4 GB, and there is about length is about, we cover the length about 2,329 centimorgan, and we developed about 2,013 markers, SNP markers, which is having a very good two constructions with this particular map. And we have a linkage map about LG20 linkage map we generated. And among them, the chromosome number 6, which is having this food diameter, food yield is concerned. Some of the QTLs are also there. And in case of linkage 5, also we have some of the traits like this food number, which is major contributor to the food yield is concerned. Coming to this important things where you got it, the mapping of the Guyanese state, the G1 trait, particularly for this, this based on this GBA study, we can find this Guyanese in the locations of a linkage group 12, which is all very much a close proximity to the two SNP, that is TP54856 and TP54890. So these we are now converting them to the through the markers like the cap markers, decap markers, that we can also have a just markers which is for the laboratory experiments. We can do it that one, and rather than going for only these SNPs markers. So that also conversions you can do it by taking these SNPs. You can utilize them, and you can use to develop or convert them the decap markers, which can be utilized for in the laboratory, the small laboratory conditions. Also, we can map, or also we can just go for marker added solutions with these cap markers if you have that particular markers is concerned. Then another important thing is this identification of candidate genes through this linkage analysis, which is very important after getting your genes of interest. If you have a QTLC, if you know the genes, but going to the particular gene, you have to clone them, and you have to particular for that, you have to go for a candidate gene approach. And that candidate gene approach we studied, that is integrated analysis of biparental and natural populations reveals in CSL and Clafata gene, that is CSCLV gene, this is which underlying the carpal number variations in cucumber. That also I worked in the US, and that also is very important for this carpal number variation, because the carpal number variations is a complex trait. It's the interaction between this Clafata gene as well as the proteins, that is WAS protein. So it is found in case of arabiasis, and that is also having three genes, that is CLV1, 2, and 3. They are most exhibiting the size of the fruit. If the carpel number is more, definitely it will be a wider fruits. That means having the fruit will be a globular shape like that of true melon, which is having carpel number is 5, or is the Wisconsin 2757, which is carpel number is 3. And you can see that there's a cylindrical fruits will be there. So based on that carpel number, the variations of the fruit size will also be there. So we have a particular interest to identify that particular genes, whether it is available in arabiasis. We just go for seeing in case of cucumber. So that we analyze this one, we publish in the tag, and that is the linkage map we also developed. we also go for the sequel, that is association mapping, also the linkage mapping, that is the biopental mapping. Then we study many things that we have to go for, how to get this candidate genes with respect to this CN number is concerned. So we have over 110 F2 derived F3 families. We cross derived from Wisconsin 2757 and True Lehman. And that segregating analysis of multiple biparental mapping populations, we have seen that CN is controlled by the simple inherited gene, and CN3, that is the carpal number 3, is generally incompletely dominant about this carpal number 3, F5. So number of 5, 3 is incompletely dominant of the carpal number 5. So that again, we just distribute them. We have seen that go for the study with this linkage map, and we have seen that 106 SNPs, particularly the look in the GY14 scaffold position. Here we have find that is which is having 47 KB region, and that is associated with this carpal number variation. And then we just screen them, we delimited to this carpal number variations with the up to from 47 to 16 KB with this, and we have seen that 5 predicted genes also here in this particular 5 SNPs with this candidate genes. So in that case, we have narrowed down that the number of genes and number of markers and number of genes to about only 5 predicted genes, which is contributing to the CN gene, which you call it the Clavada gene, and that we are using here. And we have association analysis also, we did it. We have taken a huge populations, over 47 populations. Some are having carpal number 5 and some are having carpal number 3. And you can see that all 7 cucumber lines in carpal number 5, here these are the lines which is having carpal number 5, which is having the band pattern, it is a smaller one. And then we have 3 lines behind the last band, and almost all of them are in carpal number 3. So many of them are in carpal number 3, but only 7 are found to be carpal number 5, and that we validated with this marker analysis, and you can find it. After that also, we did it some microscopy examinations of this meristem size of the 2 parents, particularly for this WA2757, we did here, and True Lehman also, we have seen that the size of the meristem, how much the size, that means as the carpal number varies, the size of the meristems also varies, which is very much of important to know that particular candidate gene. So we have seen that 85.7 micrometer is respectively in respect to True Lehman, which is even larger size of your meristem compared to this WF27, which is smaller and which is having carpal number 3. We also studied the gene expression analysis with respect to this both the parent, and you can find that the expressions of the CLV3 gene, that is the Clavada gene, which is also having 2.8, 5.1, and 5.6 times higher as in True Lehman in respect to the leaf, ovary, and terminal parts. So these highest expressions in the terminal parts have also been observed in this particular case. So that means we have also seen that CLV3 genes, which is a candidate genes, particularly for the CN, that is talponate variations in case of cucumber. So there are a lot of studies have already been done, that is the phenotypic response representations for the mutants and different cucumber. These mutants of wild type of variations also seen in case of cucumber. You can see the large leaf size, the small leaf size, the glabrous type. You can see the glabrous type is here, the round type. Then these are the all mutant type is available in case of cucumber, and the genes already derived are genes already cloned in this particular mutant type. And some of them are cloned, some of them not cloned. And these are short hypocotyl. These are another genes which also already studied. And the yellow plant variation, the crop itself, you can see, it is not that it is the deficiency symptoms. It is also a variations of these particular genotypes with respect to the leaf color is concerned. The phenotypic variations is also there. The spine size, if you see the spine size here, in case of Chinese lions, you can see the very, very large density of large size of the spines with large density spines will be there. In case of fruit, place is very important. Some are white color, some are orange color, and some are in green. Cavity size also be different in this particular aspect. And you can show the high carotene rich cucumber also you can find it. And fruit size, sap, fruit epidermal features, these are all mutant type, which is also found with respect to the particular genes is concerned. So if you see that total cucumber is concerned, the chromosomal locations of the genes in cucumber, you can find that many of these genes is also across the all chromosome, but most of them are found in chromosome 6. If you see this chromosome 5 also, we have many of them that are there, and some of the resistance lines are some of the genes which are resistance to powdery mildew, resistance to downy mildew, you can also find in chromosome 5 and 6, as well as in case of chromosome 10. So these all studies already been done. The physical locations of the genes also been well studied in GY14 background, and is found that the clone genes are all these are some of the genes are very much of cloned, particularly black, as you mentioned, with the black type. The genes noted here, they are clone genes, and some are fine map genes, those are in put in the red color. So these are the things which already published in this gene of the cucumber. Similar cases also you can find it, the chromosomal just locations of the different organs, flowers, fruits related cutules. This is also found in case of cucumber, and is also you can see that is the work by Wang et al. In 2020. They have a very good review that is in horticultural research. They have published it. And you can find it that plant related to the cutials, which is only the chromosome number 4, 1, and some of them are flower traits will be there in the in case of chromosome 1. Some in chromosome 5, you can see the plant cutials, the flower cutials, and fruit cutials. Also in chromosome 6, I mentioned that the chromosome 1, 5, and 6 having the gene of interest, which is really good to yield potential point of view. It is having resistance to biotic and hepatic diseases. So most of the genes are present in case of your, if you see the physical position found in case of 1, 5, and 6. So this is very good information, which is already published in cucumber, and which is very much required for us to develop the new lines having this particular traits or trait of interest, and which can go for marker-guided selection. The chromosome locations of the disease resistance, as I already Dr. Salim was asking about some of the just noting this one. What are the positions of the cucumber? You can find in cucumber the huge range of this resistance. You can the cutials, you can find the different chromosome. If you see the downy mildew, you can the red color of the bar, you can see downy mildew. It is across all the chromosome. If you see this, some of the background, you can find in chromosome 1. Some of the background, you can find in the chromosome 5. And some of them are in chromosome 2, and very less in chromosome 1 or 7. So they are less in 4 and 7. But similarly, in case of other powdery mildew, angular leaf spot, fusarium wilt, gummy stem blight, the chairman was telling about the gummy stem blight. This is also some of the lines already been mapped in chromosome 4 and chromosome 6. And some of the cucurbit yellows, stunting digital viruses also been mapped in case of cucumber. And across these cutials, across these chromosomes, you can find the different cutials with respect to the disease resistance concern. So if you see this genes are concerned to the melons, you can find number of 100 of genes have been already studied, and they also having these markers have been linked to this particular gene of interest, and there are also different combinations with the F2 studies, with the Becker's populations, real population, nil populations. The people have already studied there, and the number of number of genes has been identified with respect to this particular melon and cucumber is concerned. This is a cucumber genes which identified all across the different studied by the different people in different in the world itself. We have China, we have also studied in Europe, studied in the US, and many of this work has already been studied, and also they have seen that the markers, how they are useful, particularly for this breeding of this for marker state selections with respect to these disease or biotic and abiotic stresses. Some of the things has been covered by Salim, Dr. Salim was telling about these markers which is linked to the virus resistance. As you know that this virus resistance is a very, very typical situation where there were 38 viruses are seen in case of cucurbits, but very, very few. And then if you not identify the virus itself, it is really difficult to go for genetic studies. We have a complex virus traits in a particular crop. If you say this bitter gourd, if you say the cucumber, in the same time, if you have virus complexity will be there. If you have a CMB, if you have CGMB, you have your tomato leaf curl viruses, everything will be there in a particular, and you have a very, very difficult to identify the particularly the what is the SS or which is the virus, and how we go for segregating or analyzing, or how we go for link mapping in this phase is very, very difficult. But still, the people have tried with cucumber, melon, pumpkin, summer quest, Mustata, Ridgewood, and Watermelon. They already developed some of the markers in different, and these markers also you have to validate this one, because many of these markers you cannot validate But some Europe, you have in France, you have in Spain, people have worked in the stomatological viruses there with respect to the melon, and they can find that Indian this strain is also found in the Spain, and they are also having this, some of the genes they already mapped with respect to this virus is concerned, and that can also be utilized or validated in India itself. Now, coming to this high throughput genotyping, which is very, very important nowadays, don't you have to go for SSR, you have to go, don't go for the laboratory analysis. Just to you now, and now if you see that the sample, if you cost about this one, only about to this, you can sing up the some of the materials within 1 or 2 lakhs, even if you can sing up your materials. It's a very good data, data they can give it to you. So, but if you go for breeding of this high throughput genotyping, it's very, very essential nowadays, because to go for a, in the laboratory, it is really a labor consuming, it is really a very much tedious job to work hard on this particular crop and particular genotypes are with respect to the evaluations of genotyping of this particular population. But if you have high throughput genotyping, you have across 1,000, 2,000 genotypes or these populations, you can study it with this with this one, and now it is available. So if you, the study is also done by Jinping Zhang, it is in Syngenta Laboratory. And also the, when he was there in US, he has worked with the reels of different characterizations of the traits, for the real traits, and also marker is developed in watermelon. You can see the variations in the color, shape, size, and other things. And you cannot do for the simply by 100 SSR markers or some few FLP markers. It's very, very difficult to look at the genes. But if you have a very good system to go for high throughput genotyping, definitely you can have a better idea about these SNPs, where it's located, and that SNPs you can convert to your gene, to your crop of interest, or you can go for gene identifications, which also applies for your laboratory condition. But before that, if you have SNP studies, if you have SNP data, definitely you can develop your own materials or decaps, and which can be applied in the laboratory condition itself. So this is one example of the SNP markers, particularly for this Fusarium obsessorum family subspecies is Nivium, which is also studied by this group, that is Yu Wang in 2013 and Zhang also in 2013. And they can found out some of the SNPs, and there's the SNPs depicted there in the phenotypic and genotypic, and they also having the closed markers. And they studied the particular region from which this FON genes is located, and that they are utilizing for the markers that breeding program in the successive generation. Similarly, in case of powdery mildew resistance, they also find in watermelon, which is chromosome 2, and these markers, that is PM, right, BBWSO2283, which is the SNPs, which is located just near to that of only 0.1 centimeter distance, you can find it there in case of powdery mildew resistance, in case of watermelon. So, but the thing is that you have to develop the breeding populations. You can see the huge structure where you can imagine the thousands of populations are there, and they can go for SNP studies. It's not that only 100 or 200 plant populations they have taken. There were thousands of billions of people, millions of these populations they have taken, particularly for this high throughput SNP studies, and they can find some of the plants which is having resistance, as well as that SNP's locations, which also give you a broader idea with respect to resistance is concerned. They also studied the Zucchini yellow mosaic viruses, which is located in the chromosome 5. This is only because in the watermelon breeding, only because of this high throughput genome sequencing. So that is very important. If you studied that particular high throughput sequencing or genotyping, definitely you can have some of the materials you can develop with respect to any traits it's concerned. It may be virus, it may be a powdery mildew or downy mildew, whatever you like to say, but if you have the materials, and if you have a population, so thousands and thousand population, definitely selecting populations, you can go for a very precise way to develop the plants having resistance to this particular resistant to particular region pests. So these are the very important, particularly for this high throughput genotyping. Then people have started with this genome editing. This is a new science, and most of these cases you have to go for target gene target gene changing, the base pair sequencing changing. And then you have to have a two different way. One is non-pair DNA, and another is repairing the DNA. Repairing DNA is very much not so much of done in case of your other crops also in case of cocoa beets, but watermelon they studied with respect to some of the traits like herbicides resistance genes. They have already repair or the target genes has been done, and that particular replacement is also done in the knockdown and down precision turning expression system, and that is the change of this the small part of the deletions of these base sequences. There's a large deletions will be there, small insertions will be there, and the gene editing you can also do with the replacement mechanism. So these are the things which can we do it, and then there is a main impact on the gene functions. We can see that there may be lockdown, lockout, down regulations, up regulations. Also, you can find the precision turning expression. So these are the very big things happening in case of studied in the mutation studies, as well as in case of gene editing studies. So this gene editing technology can also have a better chance to have herbicide resistance genes, the virus resistance, bacterial resistance, fungal resistance, haploid induced lycopene, sugars, then shelf life. Everything you can do it if you go for a proper gene editing methods. So this is the example of the herbicide tolerant watermelon mutant by a single base replacement they did it, and they can find it that if you have replaced the particular sequence, and if you see this the wild type having this C base pair will be there, which is again changed into the T, and you can change that how much the phenotypic reactions or the validations of that one. You can see it here, and here it is a herbicide tolerant susceptible, and you can find this after these homogeneous conditions. Oh, when just to change that particular base pair, you can have that that particular plants with respect to your herbicide tolerance is concerned. If it is a heterozygous stage also, how much the reactions will be there, how much the expressions of the genes will be there, they also studied, and they have found that these heterozygous as well as the homozygous conditions of that particular T locus who are two T base pair, and that is giving to your resistance to these herbicides. So this is a very good example of this in case of watermelon. Some of the work also been done in the cucumber, and the people have tried with this gene editing with respect to the viral resistance, with respect to the bacterial resistance in case in some of the crops. Now coming to these genes, when you identify, because as I mentioned about this SNP or high thoroughbred genotyping, after that if you go for small events like marker dot selections or breeding, you can also do it. As you know that there are a lot of advantage in the marker dot breeding, because now it is a high thoroughbred gene sequence is available, and you can do a huge population to get it the markers. And that genes itself, not a marker, the gene itself, you can also modify them, and you can also develop the resistance lines. So these are the very important things and simple methods for this marker selection. This is just an addition to your conventional breeding. So that is, you have to see it. It is just addition to the conventional breeding, but conventional breeding is must if you go for this marker breeding itself. So you have to, it's very easy. And you have to save the time and resources. Also, selection at this seedling stage, particularly for the initiation stage of the plant itself, you can know the trait of your interest. And important traits for such as fruit quality can also select before transplanting, and also increase the reliability, which is very important. No environmental effects can discriminate the between homozygous and heterozygous if you have a co-dominant marker system. So these are the very things which is practiced by worldwide now. But again, this is a very important thing that not only this genotyping or marker selection alone can give you a best result, but if you have a simultaneously do the phenotypic selections as well as the marker selection, definitely you can have a better gain. And that is the maximum genetic gain, particularly for the QTLs, which is very much of a number of QTLs are more. It is very, very difficult if you go for only finding these QTLs and going for the marker selection. You have to go for penetrative variations as well. So, but the number of plants you can reduce that. So there is a very beauty of that particular marker selections with the combined approach, particular phenotypic selections as well as the genotypic selections. So that is very important. And if you go for this combined approach, you can also have a marker. If there is not accurate 100%, then again, you can also have some phenotypic evaluations by which you can combine these two genotypic and phenotypic evaluations. You can find that gun. It also reduces the population size, as I mentioned there. If you have a large population, it can reduce if you both phenotyping and genotypic evaluation should be there. So we tried with this marker development in respect to the Ganesus in cucumber, and you can find that in Indian type, and we have also having this G421, which is having American type, having pickling type. And you can see the pickling type, but only thing is that it is very much of stable to the high temperature, even up to 50 or 45 to 47 37 degree Celsius, the temperature, it will not break, but many of the cases it is breaking. So we have to convert that particular genes, that is F locus gene, that is F locus, we can say totally, and that we have to transfer to our Pusa Udai. And what we did it there with this microarray selection, and we got it Pusa Udai having 100% having this gynoecious and having number of lateral branches. If you see this G421, is only one primary branches, and there may be one or two secondary branches. But if in case of Pusa Udai, we have a number of branches are obtained, or 5 to 10 that varies, and also we have Indian type, number of branches are more. So we have to just put it this one, from this particular background to our own background, when we developed two lines having this IMP1 and IMP2, that is improved Pusa Udai 1 and improved Pusa Udai type. That's variations also, we can find it when you go for this one. And you can also take that particular genotypes particular for different, with the different background. So you have to go for foreground selections. It's a common breeding program in the case of markers breeding selection. You have to go for background selection with different markers. We have taken about 52 SSM markers. So these are the locations of the different markers with respect to the background selections. We have taken across the genes, across the genome within the chromosome 7. We have taken about 157 markers for the background selection and two markers for the foreground selections. That is for the SSR1325. And these are also utilized for this one. Now, another important thing is that is the another methods, but you can also see that microarray vector selections, which is also can broaden the genetic base of cucumber, which is very, very important. The cucumber cystics, you might be knowing, those are working in the cucumber, that is very much tolerant to root rot nematode, gummy stem blight, as well as downy mildew. So this is the hystrix from which the Hytibus is generated. So that is by Fang et al. 2002. They developed a line that is a man-made species that is Cucumis Hytibus, which is also having a 2n equal to 14. But historically, this hystrix having the 2n equal to 24, and that also they seen that this Hytibus, which is they developed, having tolerant to root rot nematode, resistant to gum blight, and that also we did it. When I worked there in US, also 7012 backcross lines and real lines, and we develop the backcross. So these are huge combinations of the backcrosses. You have to do it, and you have to go for both phenotyping selection as well as the genotype selection genotyping. Then you can develop the series of the backcross population, but both selected type and non-selected type. Both the only genetic markers, non-only genotyping. So these are the different type of combinations we created, and we have seen that we score them also, because this is the plant which is having the hystrix, Hytibus, which is having a very good, you can say that number of branches, has a good growth, having sequential fruiting. So that also we can just having these plants having very few number of fruits and having intermediate growth, having this determinate growth, that we have a number of huge populations of the plants you map. You just score them, and you just to develop and mapping, you can do it. And then you have to go for back crossing. And you can see that the plant which we started from here, and then you go to the plants having this started from here with the different backgrounds. We just put it and integrate these varieties in US, and that is now a very good pickling type of cucumbers grown in US itself. So that also we published there in particular respect to this one. But if you say that all molecular breeding approach, it is a very huge task to cover all the crops itself. But there is a lot of limitations with respect to molecular breeding is concerned in case of whether any crop, it may be cucurbits itself, because most important thing is that genomic information is not available for most of the vegetables. It's very important, because it is there is cucurbits, but which are done by the Chinese and Japanese people. They have many of the crops, they have already done the sequencing, but that sequence information is not so much away. Another important is that whatever they have that reference genome sequence is done, we have to go for pangenomic studies. At least you have to resequence number of lines. Then only you can see the variations with respect to the Chinese lines, with respect to Japanese and Indian type. So we have a different type of types we need, because we have different segments we have. We have different market segments will be there. So definitely you have to go for pan-genomic studies with respect to this markers development, with respect to this molecular breeding of the concern, and then only you can go for this breeding itself in the molecular breeding. In agro, in the QTL mapping studies, if you see the variations will be there, if you go for the Chinese materials or they have the markers what developed, and you just try it in here, you cannot find. Our material also, which are the markers we developed here, they cannot also try. But it's very, very limited scope to get that mapping studies with respect to the Q2 studies with respect to the markers. So that you have to validate very profusely, then how you can do it. Q2's effects also depend on the genetic background. As I mentioned there, these effects also vary. You have seen that some of the resistance powdery mildew it in the 5th chromosome, some are in the 1 chromosome, some are in the chromosome number 3. So that type of genetic variations will be there with the genetic background. So we have to have some of the lines which is also having this type of traits, we have to differentiate them, then only you go for this molecular breeding approach. Then lack of polymarkers, because I already mentioned, very few crops have been genome sequencing done. So you have to go for more sequencing with respect to new crops so that we can have number of markers we can develop and those we can polymorphic markers we can use for the breeding program. The poor integrations of the markers with respect to the conventional breeding. We don't have a molecular breeding approach with this conventional breeding. We must to know the about the conventional breeding first, then go for molecular breeding, definitely will be success. And we have to have an approach with both biotechnologists as well as the conventional breeder should be integrated together. Otherwise, a person having the conventional breeding also can also work in the molecular breeding. But molecular breeding to be worked with respect to the conventional breeding concerned, the initial cost for the developing the molecular breeding laboratory will be very high. So many of these laboratory in US also very few of them are working in this particular aspect. But also in India, we cannot find some of the persons who are working in the molecular breeding, but we have to try more and more in the different lab, and then only you can have a better approach there. Molecular breeding requires team of well-trained mentor. This is very important. And every scientist, all the scientists, those are working in the conventional breeding, also they have exposed to the particular field of interest, and they can go and work there. Definitely, they will be more, they confident about this work to be studied, and then also they can work in this aspect. Then gene technology involves the transgenic is another approach in the molecular breeding, but it is very, very not so much of done in India, also in the worldwide, because of this concern about the biosafety and bioethical measures, which we have to also bioethical measures as well as biosafety, which have to also proceed, and which is also a major limitation, particularly the molecular breeding. In gene technology also, the frequency of the digital transformants is very, very low, and it is also restrict the use of this technology. So if we can cover all the methods or all the things together, definitely we can build up with this work, what the Western countries are doing. Also, we can do it in India. So thank you very much. I think I'm in time. So thank you very much for giving much opportunity, Dr. T. Pradeep Kumar, Dr. K.B. Peter, sir. He's also, I am very much of that done with respect to this particular molecular breeding. Some of the things we are working here, if any students or any type of faculty members are working in different SAUs, they can also work together with respect to the cooper breeding concern, with respect to the all the private institutions also can be associated with us. So this is the things we are. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Bera, for elaborate lecture and summarizing all the facts and development taken place in the cucurbits breeding, especially in molecular level. And I hope and trust that our attendees will be benefited, and it will help to our colleague to incorporate and understand the already available knowledge for future program. So thank you very much for elaborate presentation of molecular breeding work you have carried out at IRI and your different programs, and really you have presented a very, very comprehensive overview of the program. Thank you, Dr. Sir. Thank you. Now,
thank you.
Dr. Pradeep.
Yes, I think Dr. Behra comprehensively covered the subject, and he may be ready to field some questions also. Yes, I request the participants to use their chat box so that later on, after the completion of all the talks, Mr. Saleem is here, Dr. Behra is also here. So I think in the end, we can have some 5 to 10 minutes. Yes.
Agreed, Dr. Pradeep, we will take give enough time to think to our attendee and students. If they have any queries, they can write in the chat box at the end of the presentation of Dr. Pradeep. We will take all the queries at last. Right. Now, Sangeeta, would you like to give some brief background, or I should
I will introduce.
Okay. Please go ahead.
So the next speaker for the day is Dr. Pradeep Kumar, who is the director of planning and the professional head of the Department of Vegetable Science. He has an experience of more than 23 years in horticulture research, teaching and extension at both state and national level. He has developed 6 hybrids of different crops, seedless watermelon, Parthenocarpic cucumber, and rich gourd hybrid. He is a recipient of Krishi Vigyana Award for the best agricultural scientist instituted by Government of Kerala and Harbhajan Singh Award by ISVS. He is a fellow of the Indian Academy of Horticultural Science, Indian Society of Vegetable Science, and International Society of Modern Science. He has published a lot of publications, papers, books, and chapters. I welcome you, sir, for the talk.
Okay, the permission of the chairman.
Yeah, please go ahead, Dr. Pradeep. Please go ahead.
Thank you. So I'll be talking on the application of parthenocarpy and polyploidy in cocoa beans, two different phenomena, but this two phenomena has a lot of economic significance. So let us see, first of all, what's parthenocarpy? Parthenocarpy is natural or artificially induced fruit development without pollination and fertilizer. So this is emerged from two Greek words. One is parthenos, meaning virgin, and karpos, fruits. In fact, Knorr in 1902 coined this term, parthenocarpy. And what's the criteria? It should have no seeds. There should not be any traces of aborted seeds. And also a much reduced number of seeds. So that's the criteria given for a parthenocarpic fruit. And what are the types of parthenocarpy? We have genetic or natural parthenocarpy and artificially induced parthenocarpy. In genetic, we have obligatory, that is means no external influence. You can see in the case of Ivy Gourd or Coccinea and Cucumber, it's a kind of obligatory parthenocarpy. But we have a facultative parthenocarpy also. Sometimes the adverse conditions induces parthenocarpy. And we can also have this artificially induced parthenocarpy by the application of irradiated pollen, as well as the application, external application of the growth regulators, particularly auxins and gibberellins. And genetic parthenocarpy based on the stimulation requirement, again, the under classification vegetative parthenocarpy that we have seen in the case of cucumber or coccinea. We have stimulative parthenocarpy, just a stimulus of pollination is required, or an external stimulation is required. Then we have stenospermocarpy, where the pollination and fertilization takes place, but the embryo gets aborted subsequently, resulting in seedlessness. That's a stenospermocarpy, where we have seen many grapes released through this means. So what are the requirements of parthenocarpy? There should not be any pollination. So this pollination absence can be, we can have this manifestation through male sterility or self-incompatibility. You can have the adverse environmental condition which induces the parthenocarpy, or there is no pollinator or pollinizer, then also. And dioecious. All these factors may result in parthenocarpy. And we look into the mechanism. Auxin is the main growth regulator, major growth regulator, responsible for this parthenocarpic development. And GA also, high GA content in the ovules and seeds. So simultaneously, these two pathways are responsible for the development of fruits without pollination. So here, 243 genes are there, mainly PAT1, PAT2. So these genes are responsible for the development of parthenocarpy. Why you require parthenocarpy? When there is an adverse environmental condition, there may not be any pollination or pollinizer, and you require fruits. In such a situation, you want parthenocarpy. And moreover, nowadays in protected cultivation, where there is a limitation for pollination, we want parthenocarpy, exploited this parthenocarpy in all the crops. And it's a novelty, and it fetches more price. It improves the quality and shelf life. It improves the taste, pieces, and early in yield also, because most of the early flowers, they will set into fruits, as there is no need of any pollination. So these are all the advantages of parthenocarpy. So in protected cultivation, where there is no scope for pollinator, particularly in the case of cross-pollinated crops, and this is the only option. And nowadays, even in the hermaphrodite flowers, where tomato is there, people are now exploiting this parthenocarpic gene so that the fruit set can be assured even at the high temperature. So what are the various approaches, breeding methods for developing a parthenocarpic line? Because naturally, this line will not be available in many of the crop species. Only in cucumber, a natural gene is reported. And we need to go for interspecies hybridization or intergeneric hybridization. That is mainly through the intergeneric hybridization, means through stimulation, mutation breeding, biotechnological approaches, and application of plant growth regulators. So in the case of interspecific or intergeneric hybridization, mainly in watermelon, people are trying it for developing seedless fruits. So intergeneric hybridization between bottle gourd and watermelon, just now a paper came 5 years back, and they could get seedless fruits by pollinating the female flowers of watermelon with the pollen from the bottle gourd. But there are, you can see the fruit weight, fruit length, and the TSS, it is fairly good. And see the shape of the fruit. There may be, some abnormalities in fruit shape is there, but the fruit is seedless. And our interest in breeding program is how you can exploit a naturally available parthenocarpic gene, particularly in cucumber or muskmelon. So here, we are concentrating on salad cucumber, because why salad cucumber? It's the most profitable crop and the adaptable crop under poor health situation. And here, almost all the growers, they want parthenocarpic hybrids, because the parthenocarpic hybrid will yield them very good high yield, and they could harvest the fruit on every third day. So high yield potential is there, and there is no requirement of additional bees. Only thing is that you need to manage the fruit with a scientific integrated nutritional management. But now the situation in India, most of the farmers, they need to rely on the hybrids from the private sector, and it's too costly for them, most of them. Mainly they are charging from 5 to 7 or 10 rupees per seed. And particularly in the case of multi-pistillate, means for those hybrids which bear fruits in clusters, the cost is much higher. So we started a program at Kerala Agriculture University for developing a parthenocarpic hybrid way back in 2010. And we could develop a hybrid, I will come to that. Because in cucumber, when you go for the breeding program, we know that in cucumber, there are various type of sex. The predominant one is monoecious. We have andrecious, we have gynecious type, we have hermaphrodite type, andromonoecious, gynomonoecious, trimonoecious. And in certain crops, such as muskmelon, people prefer hermaphrodite flowers because of the availability of round fruit, because you will get perfectly round fruit from the hermaphrodite flowers. And we have the traditional ridge gourd, Satputia, which again bear hermaphrodite flowers. But for the hybridization program, gynaecious types are preferred and preferable, because in the previous talk, Dr. Behera was elaborating the development of gynaecious type, how he could enrich Pusa Uday, improved Pusa Uday 1 and all. So there is a scope for developing gynaecious lines so that you can develop hybrid seeds at a much reduced cost. And any parthenocarpic gene should be incorporated on the gynaecious background. That's the importance of this gynaecious trait. And we have certain important genes in the development of parthenocarpic cucumber. And we should know that one is the FG. It's also known as ACR or D or STG. This is the female gene, which induces high degree of pistillate sex expression. But it is also strongly modified by the environment and mainly from a Japanese line. And depending on the allelic difference, it can be andromonaceous, gynomonaceous or gynaecious. And again, there are two major genes. One is F or it can be GY also. But in the case of GY gene, it's a recessive gene, will give you more pistillate flowers. And parthenocarpic gene is of dominant nature, incomplete dominance. And you can see the line which now act as a source of parthenocarpy for the most of the commercial hybrids, that is MSU713-205. And another important trait which need to be incorporated in the parthenocarpic background is the PF gene, that is the multipistillate gene. So several pistillate flowers per node, and here again MSU lines are there. It can be MP or MP-2. So here the environment is very important, because in the tropical types particularly, most of the temperate lines under tropical conditions, they become monoecious. They produce both male and female flowers, and the parthenocarpic expression also change. So the temperature about 30 degrees centigrade and photo period about 12 hour long days will again a problem. So we need to develop stable tropical lines, stable parthenocarpic lines. Then only you can develop parthenocarpic hybrid suitable for this warm, humid tropical climate. Even this, most of the temperate gynaecious lines, say Wisconsin, GY14, GY25 and all, are unstable above 30 degrees centigrade. And we have some tropical gynaecious lines way back, some 30 years back, Professor Moray and his co-workers started developing these tropical gynaecious lines. There was a break after that. And again, now some tropical gynaecious lines are started developing from the public sector. And the private seed company people, they are also having some gynaecious lines. But the major challenge here is the parthenocarpic trait. How you incorporate the parthenocarpic trait in a tropical gynaecious background? So this is the work of Professor Moray and his co-workers. And they developed yellow-skinned and green-skinned type. And they could release some hybrids also. And here, we developed a hybrid known as a KPCH1 through this approach, because we have selected both male and female line. Both are parthenocarpic and both are tropical gynaecious in nature. Because that is the most important aspect. You need to select both male and female line as parthenocarpic line. The moment you choose a monoecious line or a non-parthenocarpic line as one of the parent, your parthenocarpy will be compromised. That trait will be jeopardized. So you cannot afford to have a monoecious line or even a gynaecious line in your background, both the lines should be parthenocarpic for ensuring high parthenocarpic expression. So how you maintain that? You can maintain it through GA or sulfate, and then you select the plants which exhibit high parthenocarpy. Here the selection pressure is important and your selection atmosphere is important, because you need to have a tropical tropical microclimate and the polyhouse situation where you intended to release that particular hybrid. So both these lines should be subjected to severe selection under that particular climate, and you need to advance the generation, this inbred, at least for 4-5 generations to see that it's a true inbred. And then we develop two cultures, and then we cross these cultures and we produce this KPCH1, and it was released in 2017, and in last year 2019 it was notified by the Central Seed Subcommittee for Kerala also. Now we are marketing the seeds throughout India. Even in the COVID period, we were able to meet the requirement from even from Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh. So this is the KU parthenocarpic cucumber hybrid. You can see the fruit load in the lower nodes. See the number of plants, number of fruits in the range of 25, and average fruit weight is more than 200 gram, 20 centimeter length. And see the parthenocarpic expression. It is having more than 90%. Parthenocarpy, and average yield is 5 kg per plant, 5.2 kg per plant. So this is the farm trail, some farm trail data. And even we tried it under open condition, under shaded situation, this is performing well. Under Kerala situation, you know, in Kerala, it's a hot, humid climate during summer period. The temperature is above 32-33 degrees centigrade, but along with the humidity, it's a major limiting factor. But still, under shaded situation, under open conditions, we are able to recommend this. And these are all the parthenocarpic cucumber varieties from Pannagar under Dr. D.K. Singh. This PPC1, PPC3, and PPC2 were released. And this is the KPCH1, and from IARA, BPAC6, 10. These are all the, I think, contribution from Dr. Munshi and his co-workers from IARA, New Delhi. And we have a lot of parthenocarpic cucumber hybrids from private sector. Just mention a few. Hilton is the most popular one in South India. Kian is also there. And Namdhari is marketing. So a lot of them are marketing, but most of them are importing seeds from Malaysia and Thailand and repacking and selling it. And these are all the... See the fruit quality. Most of them have a, you can see from the photos, they have a common ancestry. That's why we don't find much difference. Only thing is the difference in the fruit size. That's all. Color is the same, dark green background. So we can, again, parthenocarpy seedless fruits can be developed through mutation. So what is mutation? We all know it's a sudden heritable change, and we have physical mutagen and chemical mutagen. And we people are trying different agents, and irradiated pollen was the most commonly applied one for developing seedless fruits. And in watermelon, they tried this. The most of the work is from Japan and China. So they tried this irradiation dose in the range of 600 GUI. And here, the major cause of seedlessness is the damage in the chromosomal double helix of the pollen and inhibiting the embryotic development process, and leading, which lead to the abortion of the embryo. In Kerala Agriculture University also, we tried this. We tried gamma-irradiated pollen with the irradiation of the 50 GY gamma irradiation. We tried both the 25 and 50 GY, and the 50 GY produces the fruits with a low number of seeds. Both in Sugar Baby and Durgapur Lal, we tried, and you can see the effect with the 50 GY and 25 GY. With the 50 GY, the number of seeds were reduced much. In the case of, particularly, you can see the in the case of Durgapur Lal, the reduction was much prominent and compared to control. From 960, you can see that the seed number was reduced up to 69. So irradiated pollen is an effective way for reducing the number of seeds. And it is genotype wise difference is there. And we can popularize it. And in fact, in Southeast Asian countries, they are using this technology on a wider scale. You can see the difference in sugar baby, how we use it. And when we use this 50 GY, the seeds were aborted. Only white aborted seeds were found in the most in the pulp. In Durgapura Lal also, you can see the size difference, seeds of the normal fruit and seeds of the irradiated fruit. So you can consume it. And another approach is the application of the plant growth regulator, particularly gibberellins. This gibberellins at the pre-anthesis spray, that was a way back, 50 year back recommendation in watermelon. TPPU is now at the pre-anthesis time is used for developing seedless foods. And we have this biotechnological approach, this transgenic plant, particularly gene, IAM with a high auxin content. Similarly, placenta and ovary specific promoters are there. And this approach is used for developing transgenic cucumber. And this product, particularly in cucumber and muskmelon, but of course, due to the regulatory restrictions, this is not popularized. But the technology, the transgenic technology, is standardized for developing seedless foods in cucumber and muskmelon. So this is in short about the approaches of and exploitation of the parthenocarpic gene, parthenocarpic trait in cucurbits. And the major application is in cucumber. Now I will switch on to the other phenomena, that is polyploidy breeding in cucurbits. So we all know from the intermediate class onwards, we know the importance of polyploidy in the development of crop species, in the speciation of the crop species. We have autopolyploidy, allopolyploidy, and segmental allopolyploidy in different crops, the classic works of compilation of the stebbins. And it is, in fact, this is genomic duplication. And there are mainly two ways by which polyploidy is originated. One is through chromosomal doubling, and also through the fusion of the unreduced gametes. So chromosomal doubling may be a two-step process, but the fusion of the unreduced gametes, a single-step process involved in the formation of polyploids. And the most important consequence of polyploidy is the Geiger's effect, increasing the cell size. So you can see, particularly in the case of watermelon, I'll come to it, the leaf shape, leaf size is exactly duplicated. So there is a Geiger's effect associated with the polyploids. So what are the applications in cucurbits? The most important application, we all know, that's a triploid hybrids, development of triploid hybrids. Then it is used for the synthesis of new species, and tiding over the fertility barrier is a major aspect there. Then tetraploids, straight away people are using, developing tetraploids, and these tetraploids are nowadays used as a varieties, particularly in watermelon, because of the low seed number. So let us see the development of seedless watermelon. It's the most important area in cucurbits. Diploid is converted to tetraploid by the use of colchicin or any other inducing agent. And later on, this tetraploid is crossed with a diploid to produce a triploid. And this triploid requires pollinators. And with the help of the stimulation from the pollinator, this will develop seedless fruit. So this is, in short, the story of the seedless fruit in cucurbits, particularly watermelon. And Usha Badana story, we all know, it's a definite ingredient of all vegetable breeding textbooks. Way back in 1916, from in IRA, it was developed. Tetra 2 was introduced from USDA, and it was crossed with a line developed at IRA, and the Pusa Badana was released. Now the seeds are not available. It was not for commercial cultivation, but we proved, we demonstrated that this can be done, and the seeds of were very good quality. In later on, there were several approaches at several agriculture universities. They were trying this development of seedless watermelon at the Institute of Horticulture Research. From using Arka Manik as the background, they tried this. And at Kerala Agriculture University also, we tried to develop the seedless watermelon, and we could develop two seedless hybrids. And our starting material was Sugar Baby. With the Sugar Baby, it's from NSC, they introduced from US. And this was the most popular watermelon variety in Kerala, particularly highly suitable for this hot, humid climate. So the starting material, we tried Sugar Baby, and we used 0.5% colchicine. This colchicine can be applied both as a seed treatment as well as seedling treatment. And we standardized different techniques for that. And tetraploid generations were developed, C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, like that. And this advanced generations were tested for their stability and fertility. And ultimately, we could develop one stable tetraploid line from Sugar Baby, that is KUCL Tetra 1. This is a perfect indigenously developed tetraploid stock from Sugar Baby. And for the last 10 years, we are maintaining it under isolation. And almost 15 generations were over. It's a very stable line. And this was used for from colchicine seedling treatment we used. And when we use colchicine, you will get mixoploids, and you need a lot of luck also. Systematically, you need to select the correct tetraploid. And you should go for chromosome counting, other than the other phenotypic selection indicators like the size of the guard cell, pollen cell, stomatal pore cell. All those things also we can use simultaneously to screen the tetraploid from diploids. Size of the pollen grain is also an important indicator. So you can see the size difference between the pollen of the in C2 generation. See, you can see the size difference. See. From 30, 29 up to 51. So this is an indication of the changes in the ploidy level in the C2 generation itself. There will be a lot of mixoploids and you will be confused. So that is the most important challenge, and you need to screen a lot of plants, thousands of plants you need to screen in the C2 generation. Then only we will get a tetraploid, stable tetraploid. And the days taken also, compared to diploid, this tetraploid will take more time for flowering. See the difference in the fruit size between 2x and 4x in the C2 generation. So the fruit characters, even the ring thickness between the diploid and tetraploid, there is a huge difference. And the tetraploids are of smaller fruits. The fruit size, you can see, they get compared to diploid, it is only 1.5 kg, perimeter size is small. And also the TSS, the most important quality aspect, the TSS, it is high in tetraploid than diploid. So in such a, and also it's having a thick cuticle, and a lot of breeding work has been done by the resistant breeding program for developing resistant lines using tetraploid. So this is in general about the characters of the C2 generation. It produced smaller fruits, less number of seeds, and seeds were drastically reduced from 400s to below 100. And it is much sweeter also. Then it was advanced to C3 generation. In C3 generation also, the same characters you need to select the plants, pollen grain size, the seed size difference, all these things can be taken into consideration for selecting a stable tetraploid in C3 generation. And also, another important phenomenon is the pollen grain size along with that pollen grain germination. With the germination of the pollen grain from the tetraploids also, you can take it as a selection criteria because the pollen grains will take more time for germination in the case of 4x pollen compared to 2x pollen. After 1 hour, you can see the size difference in the pollen tube between 4x and 2x. So that can also be taken as a criteria for selecting the stable 4x line. Chromosome count, it's a very tedious task because you need to develop the root you need to count the mitosis and the exact stage from the root tip. It's required a lot of expertise. So ultimately, the proof of tetraploidy will be through the chromosome counting. And the mitosis root tip, it's a very difficult task, but we need to do it to confirm it. And the leaf characters, you can see the difference between the diploid and tetraploids. The tetraploid leaves are gigantic, almost double the size. Thickness is more. And the guard cell, the length and breadth is more. So the leaf character is important. And if you are lucky with the leaf character alone, you can select a stable tetraploid line. So it produces bigger leaf and thicker leaf and bigger guard cell, which more number of chlorophyll. Stomatal count is an important. And in the case of 4x, see the size of the stomata, 18 micron, whereas 2x, it's smaller size. The aperture size is also smaller. And we could use this line as the female parent for developing red flesh tomato, red flesh watermelon hybrid. We named it as a Shonima. This was released in the year 2017. And this red flesh, this was the cross between KUCIL Tetra 1 and CL4. In fact, CL4 is the line from Rajasthan, from Durgapura. And this is the Shonima. And the same line we use for developing yellow flushed Swarna also. Because here we use a different line, imported line as the male parent, and that canary yellow pulp color was dominant our red pulp, and we could develop this yellow flush Swarna using the same female parent. So that's the advantage of this female parent. With the same stable tetraploid line, we were able to develop both red flush as well as yellow flush watermelon hybrid. And you can see the comparison between the red seedless and yellow seedless compared to its both the male as well as the female parent. See the fruit weight of this tetraploid parent is 2.66, whereas red seedless it is 3.83 and yellow seedless it is 3.28, slightly smaller fruits. Rind thickness also you can see it is thicker rind in the case of seedless watermelon hybrid, whereas the rind is thin in the case of tetraploid, but it is thicker than the sugar baby. And you can see the fruit size of the CL4. The line from Rajasthan is much bigger fruits, but the red seedless, it is having a smaller fruits, but TSS is higher. And yield per plant is comparable. So both these hybrids are now in commercial cultivation, and we are producing the seeds and distributing the seeds to the farmers, of course through assisted breeding and pollination. I was telling about the role of chromosome counting, and we standardized the flow cytometric analysis of this tetraploid, diploid, and triploid So based on the DNA content, you can see the based on the DNA content, we can classify the both triploids and tetraploids. So you can see the peak. In the case of P2, say this is the parental line. Parental line, the peak is in the first half, whereas the triploids, it is in the second half. And the parent 4, parent 2, is in the third half. So this exactly, it shows in that this is an exact triploid. You can see the peak in the lower two histogram. It is in the middle. This is the seed production plot. It's a 5 year back. This is Shovanima, this is Swarna. And we have Arka Madhurya from IHR, Tetra 1 into Arka Mani. So what are the limitations? We need to develop the breeding stock. It's a very tedious process, long process. And the maintenance is also important. So that's why there is a high cost involved in the seed production, and there is an exploitation because most of the private sector companies, they are importing seeds and marketing in India. And we have a lot of new information is there regarding the development of the tetraploid, but the most of them are patented information. Though we have the transgenics with the seedless fruits, it is not due to regulatory restrictions, it is not available in the market. So these are all the limitations in the seedless bottom. And we have triploids generated even in Coccinea. In Coccinea, we have a variety from Kerala Agricultural University that is known as Sulabha. And this was developed by crossing diploids and tetraploid. And you can see the characters. So this triploid, Coccinea, which is having very good market appeal, it produces the fruits with the green with and white stripes. And fruit yield, you can see it is 15.25. As it is propagated through cuttings, there is no problem of fertility barrier here. And another application of polyploidy is the development of the novel synthetic species. Earlier, Dr. Behra was telling about the contribution of Fenn and his co-workers from Cucumis. And here, this Cucumis hystrix is the most important species. It's showing resistance to so many pathogens in Cucumis. And it is not directly crossable with Cucumis sativus. So what they did, they developed an amphidiploid, and they crossed this Cucumis sativus and the Cucumis hystrix and developed this Cucumis hetaevus. And this Cucumis hetaevus is now advanced, and this is an important new species generated by the man in vegetable crops. And this is an important contribution. And another important contribution is by Indian scientist Bharati from NDPG here. This Mammonica, we all know that Mammonica is having, it's a very important genus. We all know the Mammonica charentia, but there are other economically important species, particularly exploited in Northeast India. Mammonica dioica is there, Mammonica subangulata is there. So they developed a new species, synthetic species, by crossing Mammonica dioica and Mammonica subangulata. And this new species is now termed as Mammonica saboica. So this B, you can see the central column. This is the flower, fruit, and the root characters of the Mammonica saboica. Whereas the first one is the Mammonica subangulata, and the last column is the Mammonica dioica. So it developed the better fruits, better roots also. And this is a classic example of the development of a new synthetic species, which can be directly used as a vegetable crop by the farmers. So this is a very good species, very good work of Bharati and co-workers. A lot of papers have been generated on this aspect. So polyploid breeding is now used as a method, as a novel method for generating new species in vegetable crop. So this is in short and of the exploitation of the Parthenocarpi and polyploidy in cucurbits. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Dr. Pradeep. You have taken good time and you have explained the basic and applied both the aspects of the parthenocarpic system as well as poloidy level, how the parthenocarpic system have been exploited for the development of variety and hybrids. And of course, you are the leader in the parthenocarpic group to exploit the hybrid development using the parthenocarpic gene. So our friend Dr. Munshi has also developed DPS6, Pusa parthenocarpic cucumber 6, which is open polity variety. And it is a really a remarkable contribution from both the side to the cucumber. And secondly, I had an opportunity to see your program number of times. Your work in KPCH1 is a really good program, good output, and useful product for the farmer. So industry can move ahead to take this hybrid through suitable MOU system from the university and can take full advantage of the seed production of this hybrid. Secondly, the emphasis you have laid down on the watermelon, especially the seedless watermelon, is also growing. You know, globally, seedless watermelon is very important. You see China, Korea, Southeast Asia, and the US market full of watermelon range is available in different flush size and with seedless. Undoubtedly, this you have surprised that Pusa Bedana is one F1 triploid hybrid developed by IRI, but could not be popularized because of the certain limitations. That time industry was not so robust. Now the seed industry is very robust. Consumer awareness is very high. Now people want more, farmers want more yield, consumer want quality and chewable seed, though the seed is also having a lot of advantage. But this is a technological intervention in the product development. And coccinea is really one development where seed is a barrier in palatability and consumer preference. So development of coccinea, seedless coccinea suluba is another good output of the breeding program. And as I mentioned that Dr. Bharti in IHR, I have also privileged to see his program. He's a wonderful worker, trained at our division. Probably it was a student of Dr. Behra or Munshi. And he has contributed very good what you have presented about the new species using the polyploidy. So you have tried to summarize all the basics applied and the current situation of the parthenocarpic and poloidy level, how it has been commercially tilted to the development of the product which Indian seed industry required. And market is now very positive to accept the new product with the high level of nutrition as you have shown. In both the background, Durgapura Lal and Pusa Ruby, the intensity of the lycopene and beta carotene in yellow flush has improved a lot. So the consumer will also be benefit with this new development. And at the end, I would like to congratulate all three speakers, Dr. Salim, Dr. T.K. Behra, and Dr. Pradeep. Out of three, two speakers are very well known to me. Dr. Pradeep is my PhD classmate, and Dr. Behra is my colleague. And we have heard this name. All three speakers have put emphasis on the basic research and how the basic information can be converted into a product, and how the knowledge of can be exploited further for the improvement of cucurbits. Because, you know, cucurbits are facing a number of problems nowadays. Virus is a threat to almost all crop. So far, we have not heard about the virus infestation in Brinjal. Now it is, Brinjal is also facing cucumber, as I mentioned in 20 years back, much problem was not there. And now almost every cucurbits is having a problem of viruses, and as the time change, the level of infestation of number of diseases and vector-based viruses are increasing. So it is one of the challenge. And in this direction, I was thinking that if the parthenocarpic mechanism or gynoecious mechanism, which is available in cucumber and bitter gourd, and if it can be transferred to the other background, though it's an intra-specific hybridization, is very challenging task. We can overcome the problem of many viruses and disease by way of developing variety and hybrid for protected cultivation. Because in the coming time, climate will change is certain, and you will feel that the early onset of the monsoon, late early withdrawal, high temperature, low temperature, intensity of the rainfall distribution has changed in the country. So to address all these issues, we have to look forward for better productivity, better quality of product to the protected cultivation. For that reason, we look forward at genotypes which requires minimum level of pollination. Because inside, if we look forward, the Indian situation where majority of farmers are small and marginal farmer, they have only 2000 square meter poly house or 1000 square meter area. Because of the financial position of the farmer, as well as the land size, land holding and support available from the government to raise the protected structures. So we should have a variety which we can be grown inside, so we can address number of problems. So this this kind of programs will give the way forward or new thinking in the direction that how the cucurbits cultivation can be promoted in open field as well as simultaneously in protected cultivation. In protected cultivation, we can utilize space vertically. The people feel that there's a mass, they produce the mass, biomass, more biomass and less productive, but we can make more productive by way of adding the these two mechanism in parthenocarpic as well as the gynoecious mechanism in two mechanism in one background. So that can be one new thinking in this direction. And secondly, that we have to now orient our programs for nutritional, because so far except bitter gourd, watermelon, lycopene and nomoridicine, charentine, cucurbits have graded in a low because of the minerals and others. So now we have to look more accumulation of the minerals and these bioactive compounds in these cucurbits, so that cucurbits value will improve. And we have to emphasize our own indigenous crop, though we are emphasizing growth in cabbage, cauliflower, tomato, chili and other crop because they are commercially important. But in Atmanirbhar Bharat, we have to look forward our own crop, indigenous crop, which are well adapted under humid tropics. Because in humid tropics, you have more problems. In North India, we have both the season, though problems are there both the side, but you have high humidity, high temperature. So you in humid tropics problem is more as compared to the north and southern growing condition cucurbits. So we have to initiate a program for addressing the viruses, though work is in progress in number of universities, and private sector is also working in this direction. So my feeling that in coming time we have to more focus on virus resistance, disease resistance, and we have to couple all these good traits into the background of already existing varieties or the hybrids, so that inbuilt mechanism can be exploited further for the benefit of the farmers. So this is my overall observation on all three presentation. I congratulate all three speakers, those who have accepted the invitation of the organizer, and give valuable time, valuable information were compiled, and their good amount of work has been presented for the benefits of participants. I could see since morning more than 160 participants are are continuously attached with the program besides the 19 panelists. So I feel it's a good number of participation in the program, and I hope and firm belief that with this kind of program will benefit with less energy, less time, and less investment. So I lastly congratulate to Dr. Pradeep Kumar and Dr. K.V. Peter sir, who has given a thought of organizing a 3 days program on a very important aspects and given me opportunity to act as a chairperson of the technical session third, which was very useful and learning to me. And though I know all these development, but listening in a systematic manner further improve the confidence and enrich the knowledge on the subject. So at the end, I thanks to the organizer, Dr. K.V. Peter sir and Dr. Pradeep Kumar T for giving me an opportunity to chair the session. Thank you once again to all of you.
Thank you, Thomas sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Kutty.
Yes.
See you.
I have been hearing you all the time. I was hearing you all the time.
Oh, thank you, thank you. Thank you so much.
Dr. Sangeeta, I think
yes,
I think forenoon session we can wind up, but on behalf of the organizers, I profusely thank Mr. Mohammed Salim, who gave a very excellent lecture on the prospects of the resistance breeding, and Dr. Behra. In fact, he is the pillar of molecular breeding of vegetable crops in India. And I think the students were immensely benefited by his contribution. And I am very much indebted to him because he is a very busy person, I know it. And his slides were of very good quality and highly informative. And lastly, to our chairman, Dr. Bhopal Singh Tomar, and he is a very knowledgeable person. He is he leads the seed production of vegetable crops in North India. Whatever problem comes on the seed production, he is the authority on the vegetable seed production and also on the warm season vegetable and cool season vegetable seed production potential. And he is a very knowledgeable person. I think his presence adds values to this session. And we are grateful to you, sir, on behalf of Kerala Agriculture University and Indian Society of Vegetable Science. I express our sincere gratitude to Professor Bhopal Singh, Dr. Behra, and Mr. Salim. Thank you all. I think, Sangeeta, we can start the session, afternoon session at 2 p.m., no?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
We'll meet again at 2 p.m.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pradeep. Thank you very much.